This episode of Beauty and the Beast podcast brought to you by TaintedVisionArt.com. Go to TaintedVisionArt.com, smoke a number, and see what they got. It'll bring a bunch of joy into your world. We're back, bitches! Felicia Michaels.
Joey Diaz.
You sexy animal on a cold Los Angeles morning.
No.
You're looking beautiful and shit with your little vest on. We got matching vests.
Thank you. I love your glasses. You remind me of like a thug in the 50s that was like the accountant.
I'm trying to count my money, but I can't see the fucking 50s and the 20s. You know what I'm saying? But I heard you were at the fucking Women's Festival, Comedy Festival last
weekend. Oh, I was at the Ventura Comedy Festival. You know what? I want to give a shout out to Randy Lubis. He owns the Ventura Comedy Club. And the first night I go in there, it's an all-girl show. I'm not a big fan of the all-girl show. But you know what? The crowd was fucking hot. The first girl on was getting applause breaks. And it was really awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. And I saw Eddie Brill, who is a comic and booker of The Tonight Show, for those of you not in the know. And it was so weird because I know Eddie from way back at the Comedy Store, like in the 80s. And when I first went to New York, I told you this story before, Eddie said, come and stay at my apartment. I go to the apartment. It's like a studio apartment with a big fucking crack on the Lower East Side, big crack in the building. Snowflakes would come in as you were sleeping on the ratty couch. And it was an apartment that was shared by Tony V and Dennis Leary. And I remember one time Tony V brought Bobcat Goldthwait up to the door and knocked on the door in the middle of the night. And I'm in my fucking coat. Like, I don't take my clothes off. That's how nasty the couch is. I don't want to use any of their blankets. I'm in my coat and I'm fucking freezing. Snowflakes are coming in on my face. I see the moonlight through the crack. And the door opens and there's a silhouette of Tony V and Bobcat Goldthwait. And Bobcat was holding a suitcase. And Bobcat looked at me, looked at the apartment and said, I'll get a hotel.
Yeah, it's one of those fucking places.
And I'm so glad I was covered up so he couldn't see that it was me, because I was like, oh, fuck.
It was a comics.
It was a great moment, and thanks to Eddie Brill, who I saw and who's always a sweetheart and a very kind and giving person in comedy. You don't run across many of those.
It was funny because you were at the festival, and on Saturday I got the call like at 12 o'clock that they had extra tickets for the UFC. So, you know, I wasn't going to go because I wanted to take my wife, you know, and then they called back and they go, well, we have an extra seat because somebody invited me to sit in a box.
Oh, yeah.
And I didn't want to really go because then it would ruin my wife's day, kind of, sort of, for an hour or two. So I said, the hell with it. And somebody called, said, we got two tickets. And I went down and I got to sit with Eddie and his wife and Ari and his wife. Nice. And then they called back and they go, we got extra tickets. Ask Felicia. And I go, and I was right around the corner having coffee. And I go, if I go, I'm going to have to pick her up. And she's going to have to cancel. She's going to feel bad.
Was no way I could cancel. And Friday night show was great, but Saturday night show, you know, would have been nicer to cancel. But there is not. Once you commit to a festival,
you got to do the festival.
You look like it. And I've done that before, so I
But it was pretty funny how this was like a historic night. Because it was MMA on Fox, on primetime television, you know? And I didn't know until on my drive down there, as I was walking in, I was feeling a little bit of this, and people were comparing it to the fucking Ali Frazier in 71 when they fought, and it was Channel 9. Yeah, because it was the first time there was a fight on television. Like, it was on television. You didn't have to pay-per-view it. Nothing, you know? And I was thinking about, here I am with my wife, and my wife really had a blast. And it's if it was up to me that day between you and I, Felicia, I wouldn't have fucking gone. Because all I was thinking about was the traffic. You know, right away,
I'm
like, the traffic.
You can be that way, I know.
And I'm thinking about the way out. And I'm like, how the fuck am I going to get out? And we went down there and we walked in. It was like no problems at all. We got our seats. You know, we got the fight. You know, people complained because it was the first time for Fox. So they didn't know what was really happening. So we sat for a while waiting for the first fight. And then there was a quick knockout, and, you know, we got back in the car, and we got out. You know, it took like 20 minutes to get out. But the nicest part of the night was that on the way home, Eddie called, and he goes, hey, you want to go get something to eat? And we were going to go to Fogo de Chao. And I was on the 210, which is the back way.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, Eddie, I'm all the way. They took the fucking 5, you know. Thank God you introduced me to the 210 that time, to the 57,
right,
to the 60. It cuts. Yeah. You're in L.A.
Yeah.
It cuts L.A. in half.
Yeah.
And you go down the 57 to Irvine. And it bumps right into the 5. So for people who don't know what the fuck I'm talking about, don't worry about it. I've been here for 13 years and I just learned this shit. So he called and he goes, hey, let's go eat. You know, I'm like, I'm on the 210. He goes, well, pick somewhere in the middle. I go, let's just go to Burbank. We're going to go to McCormick and Schmidt's.
Uh-huh.
And we ended up going to Black Angus.
And
as I'm walking in there, I'm like, my asshole is going to be in pain in 2 hours because that food usually goes right through me. And me, Ari, Eddie, Ari's date, we all went and it was... It was like a family dinner. I haven't had that in so long. It was like a family fucking dinner. But what made my night complete was, and a lot of people don't know this, was Joe Rogan. Because Joe Rogan gave us the tickets. And it's so weird that Joe doesn't blow his own horn. Like, Joe calls me while I'm sitting there, which he never does. I'm sitting there, and I look at my phone, it's Joe, and I go, what's up? And he goes, where are you? And I go, I don't know where I am. I'm on the floor. I don't fucking know. You got the tickets. Where are you? And I'm looking for him, and all of a sudden I go, listen, the landmark was Tito Ortiz.
Uh-huh.
You know, Tito Ortiz was at Jenna Jameson getting autographs and taking pictures. I go by Tito and look, and I'm right there. So he goes, all right, hold on, I see Tito. So he walks over, he sees Tito, and he's like calling me back, where are you? Where are you? Put your hand up. So I put my hand up, and he walked over to us in that section and sat with us, and he had like this, you know, he couldn't wear like his Affliction shirts or anything. It was Fox, so he had to wear like a black shirt that uh-huh. was like custom fit and stuff and black pants.
Oh, I'm sure he looked good, yeah.
He looked good, he had a wire in his mouth. And he came over, and Eddie looked at me, he goes, he never comes over. And I go, Eddie, his head's about to blow up. You know, a lot of people don't know, when Joe took that job, he took that job for free.
Oh, yeah, I know.
As a whim.
Yeah.
He was on news radio, and he would call and say, do you mind if I come do the fights and watch the fight for free?
You know what? I tell people that story all the time.
That story is mind-boggling. And he went, and he did a couple of them, and then they offered him a little money. Then they offered him a contract. And you know what? This is a guy that... this is what he does second nature. It's like hiring me to talk about music. I do this second. I mind fuck myself with this shit. This is my mind fuck to escape his music, you know? So it's weird that I seen this guy. I remember he used to ask me, do you want to go? I'll pay for your plane ticket on Southwest. Like, he used to fly Southwest. Like, that's how we used to. And I would say no. I was embarrassed. And then finally I broke down and I started going to him. And I watched his growth. And I really... have to give him kudos, because everybody always talks about, oh, you know, I don't have a job, or I don't do this. And sometimes you have to create your own job. And that motherfucker created his own job, and he's going to go down like a Howard Cosell for MMA.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's really interesting, that whole progress of how he did that. And you know what's really, I find, mind-blowing is when you go into like a different... type of thing. Like when I went to the first UFC fight in
New Orleans,
when you see like the culture of it, like I had no idea. You see it on TV, but you don't understand until you go to the fight, the culture of the UFC. And when you think about, wow, Joe Rogan went there and was just goofing and was very serious about it, but just did it for, you know what I mean, out of the pleasure of it, like you're saying. It's interesting when people that in comedy become part of the lexicon. And I was thinking about that because I wrote a joke about the UFC after New Orleans, and I was Googling a bunch of stuff, and I was trying to Google like moves, you know, names of moves, you know, that they do in the wrestling. And then I read about Joe Rogan, and he said one time about someone doing the rape choke. And like it made me take pause, like, wow, he's doing what he likes to do. It's all new. He just calls out a thing, and now that's part of the lexicon. You know what I mean? Like, that's amazing to me.
It's an amazing story. And people sit there and figure out, you know, what am I going to do with my life and stuff? And they figure out what they're going to do to make money. And they figure out. And sometimes you have to figure out that you have to find out what you like. And the money will come. And you know, it's like this podcast. You were saying that the numbers were great this week. We started out, we're not stars, we're not celebrities. We just came on and poured our soul. And Felicia, when I came in, said, Joey, the fucking numbers have been amazing. So we want to thank the fans.
We do.
Or whatever
want to
the
thank
fuck
you
people are, fans. Or
we
just,
don't want to sound cocksuckery,
you know,
by
people,
saying fans,
yeah,
but the listeners.
The listeners,
yeah.
That really believe in us and what we're doing, and we really reach out to you. And in turn, we got a great sponsor out of this. We just got taintedvisionart.com. I didn't know much about them. They contacted me. We went back and forth. And I looked on their page, and it's neat stuff. Like, I looked at it again last night. Like, they have skate decks. Do you know what a skate deck is, Felicia? No, yeah, I didn't know either. The top of the fucking skateboard that you put the wheels.
Okay.
And they have, like, fiberglass, all this stuff with different designs, stuff that you can't get in the store. They got vinyl figures. Listen, you know what? I know you got 20 bucks in your pocket to get a vinyl fucking figure sometimes, just to put on your desk to goof around. You ever hit yourself in the fucking elbow? You ever hit your elbow? Today I hit my elbow against a beam at Bank of America. I went to deposit a check for $369 and another check for 80 cents because I was killing time till I came here this morning. I go, got these two checks laying around. I bang my beam. And when you bang your banana bone, is that what you call it, your elbow? Every time you bang your banana bone, it comes back to you. Like, as soon as I hit it, I'm like, I haven't had that pain since I hit myself with the nunchuck in the eighth grade. Because when you hit the nunchucks, you always hit your elbow and your fucking head. It's amazing. I got a pain in my elbow. I can't even whack off now. They go, so it's fucked. I got to oil up my elbow like the tin man.
Yeah, fuck the Achilles heel.
Yeah,
the funny bone is a motherfucker.
It's a motherfucker. They also have resin figures. They also have great books. What I dig, they have clothing. What I really like that they have are the rock posters. They got classic rock posters like Deadhead, The Doors. They got a Lollapalooza poster. They got a Kiss poster from Long Beach. They got a Motley Crue poster at the Whiskey and Go-Go. They got so much stuff on there. They got free shipping if you spend over $99. They got gift certificates. Do me a favor. Do what I did. Smoke a number and go on their webpage. You're going to be fucking blown the hell away. Go to www.taintedvisionart.com, you know, and they're going to set something up. Just look at the webpage, give us a week, and they're going to set something up. So if you order through Beating the Beast podcast, you're going to set a percentage off. We're going to work something off for you, half on shipping, something. Let me figure it out. My man Derek over there, they're a great company. Listen, support them because they support us and they'll keep us alive. And in turn, this whole wheel of ours keeps going. It's a circle. And it's
wonderful,
a circle of
wonderful.
Good karma. Speaking of good karma, I don't know, when we first started the podcast, I did a podcast with Felicia. Felicia made fun of me about my fans, you know, about the people that I like growing up. She was talking about me, you know, she tried to break me down, asked me if I would suck James Coburn's dick and all this. And I was talking about in front of my wife, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, your fucking wife Felicia almost got no peed fuck. Herself. She laughed so
Felicia
hard.
Got no fucking class, you know what I'm saying? She breaks me down in front of my wife. You want to break me down when we're alone and shit.
She
that's
knew.
Fine, cocksucker.
She winked at me as I was saying.
But I was talking about James Coburn. I was really talking about, you know, when you come from another country or whatever, when you're a kid and you aspire. I always wanted to aspire to be Charles Bronson. I talked about Charles Bronson. And one of the listeners, a fucking great artist by the name of Mike Maxwell from San Diego, drew this picture, contacted me. I told him my address. 2 days later, it was in my fucking house, and I had a tear in my eye. Because not only was the gesture a beautiful gesture, but the picture he drew was mind-boggling. And every morning, I put it in front of me to think about Charles Bronson to remind me who the fuck I really am. You follow what I'm saying to you? And I've always loved Mike Maxwell because of this. Whenever I go to San Diego, he shows up at the show, and he don't come empty-handed. He comes with an edible, a fucking joint, a bag, a bazooka, and a picture that he drew for you of the week. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
You can't, when somebody draws something for you, it means so much to you. I got his shirt at my house that I won't wear because it's such a cool shirt, like a design with an ape and stuff. Mike is just a neat guy. He got invited to do the Miami Basil Art Festival 2011. He went on Facebook yesterday. And I think the plane ticket was like five something, and he got like 400 and ones and tens, the same way I did for the documentary.
Uh-huh.
And I'll tell you what, that's what Facebook is about, and Twitter, in a way, to me. It connects a lot of same-minded people.
Uh-huh.
You know, when I look at Twitter and I lose three people, I know that they got pissed off because I said a joke about some stupid shit that I talk about in my fucking perverted mind. And I understand if you don't like my sense of humor, but it cuts down because it lets the people that want to be in your realm be in your realm. And in that realm, I have fighters, I have drug dealers, I have, you know.
You do have an interesting realm.
And I love them all. I love them all because we all connect by one fucking thing that we said. They felt that we all connected in a certain way. So we're all artists in a way. I don't even give a fuck if you're an engineer, you're an artist in my book because you're aspiring, you know? So Mike Maxwell's an artist. We're trying to get some hotel money from him, a little money to get some Cuban food when he's down there. I don't want him walking around with fucking, you know, with bunny rabbit ears. So whatever you could donate, he's on PayPal. So go to MikeMaxwellArt.com. Read his blogs, you know, he's got interesting stuff on there, and help him out. You got a fin, throw a fin. If you got a fucking cousin in Miami that sells a weed, just do that. When he gets to Miami, bring him a $10 bag of weed. We're all in, we're all connected, so thank you very much, people. Between you people listening to us and supporting us and the podcast and Felicia. Felicia, I'm getting more and more fucking emails about how hot Felicia is, what they want to do to you.
Well, that's nice to hear.
So I'm thinking we're doing a Beauty and the Beast calendar with just Felicia, all 12 months.
No.
with not pussy shots, nothing tasteful, you know what I'm saying? Because people need, don't
no,
giggle,
you
don't fuck,
want
she's giggling.
Pussy.
But you know, you don't have to show your pussy.
I can't show that pussy.
No, no,
anymore.
You can't show those titties. They're beautiful. But a couple, you know, that shot of you with the fucking black on with the little whip in your hand that I like. All those things. That's a calendar.
Oh, that's a calendar.
And you know what? You're beautiful. Why keep hiding it or whatever?
Maybe I need to Photoshop a little Joey Diaz.
No, I don't want to. I don't belong in there. I don't belong. There's no beauty in me. This is about beauty, not beast. Beast is other
you
things.
Are I'll the show, beauty, though.
I'll
that's
show crime scenes
get.
And shit like
You're
that.
You're the
you know
beauty. I'm the beast. I'm the beast, cocksucker.
Cocksucker. Anyway, we got a guest and we'll be back, bitches. We're going to blow your mind with this one. For the last couple of weeks, for a year, it was just basically me and Felicia, and we introduced a couple of guests. But Felicia got a wild bug up her ass recently, and she goes, Joey, we got to get some fucking guests on
Dude,
here.
Dude, we need a guest for a
we
while.
We need a guest for a while. And we always try to bring guests on here that, yes, they're in our circle, or some that are kind of crazy, and we just find on the street or something, which I've been looking for lately.
Oh, yeah?
I'm just looking for a fucking pedophile or something, somebody, just to interview them. And, but I wanted to start with the people that are in our life. And when we sit them down, I don't want to go to the obvious with them sometimes, because you hear that on other interviews that they do. So we want to hit them from a different perspective sometimes, which is really neat. Uh-huh. It's very neat. And today's guest is one of my favorite people in the fucking world. We all went to the movies one time. You know, me, him, and Felicia went to see
the Charles Bronson
double feature. He showed up. And I love this kid with all my heart. He's the president and the fucking honorable czar of 10th Planet Jiu-Jitsu, my little brother, Mr. Eddie Bravo, in the fucking house. Guess what jam I listened to this morning, Eddie, because of you. And I got to tell you something, not one of the heaviest jams ever, but it's such a smooth fucking jam with such a badass guitarist that you sit there and you go, wow.
Let me guess. Give me a clue. I'll guess.
We just talked about him the other day at the table.
We talked about a lot of bands.
But we talked about he replaced Randy Rhoads.
Oh, wait a minute. You listen to Night Ranger?
Yeah. What song?
You Can Still? Sister Christian?
No.
You Can Still Rock in America?
Even better than that. Down now, na-na, when you close your eyes.
Oh my God. About me.
Oh my God. I was walking and it was on the iPod and I didn't feel like switching it. And it came on and we were talking about Night Ranger. And I said, let me hear out the song. And by the middle of the song, I said, how brilliant is this song? Because here's a guy that could blow the fucking speakers out of a fucking guitar. And he had to just chill. And it's
that
a
is
really
crazy.
It's a crazy fucking jam.
Are we on the air?
Yeah, we're just talking right now. We warm up like
this. Yeah. It was very interesting.
You remember Night Ranger?
Yes, I know Night Ranger.
We're talking about Night Ranger people.
But as a girl, like, girls don't have these usually kind of conversations. So it's always very interesting when you see guys go off on music. It's cool.
We guys are into the band members and their personalities and their style. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. Like a certain band's bass player. Girls generally aren't into it unless they're lesbian. Like the drummer for, you know, Metallica or something, you know.
Yeah.
Everyone is a character. And Brad Gillis, well, first of all, Ozzy Osbourne, everybody knows Ozzy's the biggest rock star of all time. Reality show and legend at the same time. Reality show legend and real life legend, Ozzy. He was the singer of Black Sabbath. He went and did solo and became bigger than Black Sabbath. He's like, you know, all these rumors about him biting off bats' heads. He's a legend. All those legendary stories. He does a reunion tour, a farewell tour, actually, like every year. It doesn't stop. He has Ozfest. He has like the most successful rock. This guy's huge. And then he does a reality show. I mean, everybody knows who Ozzy Osbourne is. Everybody, you know, children, everybody. He's the biggest rock star ever. Well, anyways, when he left Black Sabbath, when he formed his the first band, he found a guitar player named Randy Rhoads, and that guy was just everywhere he went, everybody knew he was just this, you know, this golden child guitar player, and he just like walked onto Ozzy. Ozzy was like, man, he was used to playing with Tony Iommi in Black Sabbath, and the guitar player for Black Sabbath was actually, out of all the famous guitar players ever, he's probably known as the least technical. He writes amazing riffs, the heaviest, darkest riffs. Black Sabbath, his riffs, Tony Iommi's riffs, just started a whole new genre of darkness. And it came from Black Sabbath. That was the darkest band. They were in the 60s and dark as hell and all these satanic references. They were heavy as hell. he had amazing classic riffs. No one will ever touch Tony Iommi as far as coming up with those heavy riffs and those evil riffs. Like Heaven and Hell, when you hear that, when you hear those guitar chords, it's so simple, but it's so godly. But technically, as a lead player, he was actually known as a dude who just wasn't, he didn't really care about leads. He just cared about coming up with awesome riffs. And all of a sudden, Ozzy goes solo and gets this shredder, this guy that's, the at that point in time,
he was him, a baby.
Yeah,
he was 21. He walked into this
Randy Rhoads.
Yeah, he walked Randy into Rhoads. This audition. He was playing with
Quiet Riot.
Quiet Riot.
Yeah,
and he, you know, he walked into this audition, and he
was like 78.
And he's a gorgeous man. He's sexy. A beautiful blonde. You know, hair, the whole thing. And Sharon, the fucking genius that she is, said we gotta have him. And it was this just when you listen. You know, when the guitar player...
Sharon Osbourne. Now, this goes back. Like, everybody knows Sharon Osbourne. Then it goes... This is like... the
genius!
This is...
Genius!
Ozzy was the lead singer of Black Sabbath, the godfathers of heavy
genius.
Metal. The godfather.
Genius shit.
Before fucking... There were... Like, Led Zeppelin wasn't really dark and heavy. They were like boogie rock and roll. Black Sabbath was Slayer in the 60s.
Reality music, you know, acid.
And Ozzy had there's some, I mean, classic all-time classics. Shit. I mean, like Iron Man. Everybody knows Iron Man. You could use that as a Super Bowl commercial, and everybody would know what Iron Man is.
People do. Or,
you know?
Paranoid, somebody's using it now.
Paranoid is probably the most covered song at backyard parties ever. Every band covered Paranoid.
I went to somebody's house, and they didn't have the album Paranoid. I didn't even hang with them.
There was no...
Like,
yeah.
You know, you look through somebody's...
Right.
I got two bad habits.
Yeah.
I got two bad habits. I look through people's albums. And the other day, Brian Callen was on Joe Rogan's podcast. And they were talking about people going into people's refrigerators. Yeah. And Joe said, listen, man, that's a taboo in my house. There's two people who could look at my refrigerator. And that's Brian Callen and Joey Diaz, because he's going to do it anyway. I judge people by their refrigerator. If you got a shitty refrigerator, I can't hang with you.
Yeah.
I got to see shit in there, eggs, mayo, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you're the type of guy that opens dudes' refrigerators?
Yeah, like when I went to your house.
Does that. Yeah, nobody does that to me. I would think that was like if someone just came to my house and just opened shit up, I would be like, dude,
slow down
a little bit.
No, no, after I get to know you,
exactly, what I'm saying?
You look at somebody's refrigerator, you can tell what type of person they are. If they got character, if they got leftovers, if they hold that shit to the...
I'm too much of a pussy.
No,
I mean, you know what I mean?
Let me ask you this.
I don't have the balls to do
when
that.
When you were doing petty crime, did you look in people's refrigerators?
No, I don't have the time.
Okay.
I got to hit and run. I'm on a time clock, you know what I'm saying?
You got to be a bad motherfucker to walk into some dude's house and just open up a shit and start eating shit and open up cereal and porn. And you know, you gotta have tremendous nuts. I can't do that.
I told you that one time in Houston. That was the lead off to that. When we used to go to Boulevard East and, you know, mug people down there, we had a friend. Like, it went from one extreme to the other, and people started getting crazy. Like, you go for an arm bar, then you go for a fucking neck thing. You know, and people just get, it was like, who was outdoing who? And there were these three brothers, the Thomas brothers. They were Irish, they were all missing a tooth. All of them were missing a front tooth. Beautiful Irish dudes. But Chrissy Thomas and Davey were the kings of mugging people, taking them back to the house, tying them up, and they would fry eggs. That was their thing,
really?
Like to cook and call people. Hey, we're over here frying eggs. We got the guy sitting down tied up, whatever the fuck they would torture. They wouldn't do nothing to the guy. They were just mugging him, whatever. But just the fact.
They weren't doing nothing to him, but just mugging him.
Breaking into somebody's house and cooking something. That takes balls.
Oh, totally.
That's fucking balls.
Like, is that in a movie somewhere?
No, he robbed me, and then the motherfucker made eggs. Yeah. Like, he made eggs.
Because he knew you couldn't go to the cops. Because the only way you would do that is because you know you ain't going to the cops because you're going to bury yourself. So you could do that. You could tie a motherfucker up. Like, where are you going to go to the cops? But, like, normal people, you tie someone up and you make breakfast. Man, you got to kill the person you tied up because if they call the cops and they, you know... You can't, that's some heavy shit. You can't be cooking. You can't cook in someone's house unless you're sure they're not
to, right?
I can't
way.
Flip you out like that.
Right?
Listen, hold on one second.
By the way,
let's go back. Yeah. We digress, though. Go.
Oh, I just wanted to say, how lucky am I that I got to get schooled by Joey Diaz and Eddie Bravo over Black Sabbath?
And like, we're not even done yet.
We're not even done because this one gets better. Yeah. They bought him out. Like I was telling Eddie, I went to the tour with Van Halen where Van Halen just destroyed him.
It and was Ozzy like a, was still with Black Sabbath.
And Ozzy was still with Black Sabbath.
The darkness.
And they were together and it was horrid. It was like just 70, horrible. 78. I was a freshman. It was horrid. And I went home going, wow, I really got to listen to these motherfuckers. And I had just bought Master Reality and I was like, ugh, that's a really dark one. And then they broke up and I was shattered. Like as a kid, I was shattered. Like my mom died, then fucking Black Sabbath breaks up. What the fuck? Then the drummer from Led Zeppelin died. I was like shattered, all these fuck. But then Ozzy came back. But the true story was that he was in such bad shape. He was living above that liquor store, Gus's, right on Sunset. He was living at some dingy hotel. And he was just ordering booze from Gus's. And the daughter, who was Sharon, was her father was a famous manager. And she said, what are you going to do with this fucking guy? And she goes, he's dog shit. I don't want him. And Sharon said, you don't want him. I'll take him. And she goes, go. Take him. He ain't shit. He's done. He's on heroin. He's shooting fucking ants in his arms. He's done. And that's the true story of that. That's the fucking American dream. That bitch went over there, took him out of the gutter. You know, it was half of it was a marketing ploy. But it was perfect. She believed in him.
Very, I would say more than not, the lead singer of a big band usually fails going solo. Off the top of my head, that's not an easy thing to do. It's not guaranteed that you're going to leave a big entity, Black Sabbath, you're going to start your own shit and it's going to be successful. It could fucking tank hard. Like, you know what I mean? Because Tony Iommi was the one who writing all these dark riffs. Ozzy wasn't writing the music. He was writing the lyrics and shit, but he wasn't writing the music. You think you could find another Tony Iommi to write that music?
He came at you with a different style, Ozzy. Yeah.
Oh, exactly.
He and came at you with a different style.
When they
style.
Found Randy Rhoads,
oh,
when they found Randy Rhoads, that first album just destroyed. You know what? That album was so good that it hurt me because I was on a little different tip. He grew up, you got to understand, as kids, we get attached to music, boys usually, metal, rock. We know everything about every goddamn band that we're into. We break them down. I know who wrote the goddamn songs. I know when they brought a studio musician into work. I know all that shit. I go into all that if I really like the band. I remember being 8 years old at school, and my stepdad, who was a horrible person, I'm 8 years old, I'm living with my stepdad. He was a Mexican dude, hardcore Mexican, didn't speak perfect English, but he spoke like Tony Montana English. But he was a Porsche mechanic. This guy was, you know, he was a total douchebag, but he had his shit together. He was a Mexican Porsche mechanic in Newport Beach. He was the best one. He was making cash. He had cash. My stepdad had cash. He was a genius Porsche mechanic. And like the two Porsche dealers, the biggest ones in Newport, were like battling for him. It was a douche to me, but he's a real smart guy. And he loved classic rock. That's all he liked. He hit me with everything, but I hated him so much. So a lot of the shit
you
he liked,
against
I was
him.
Like, fuck that.
Fuck that.
You know, he loved going camping, and my evil stepdad loved going camping. He never gave me any love, and he'd beat me down every now and then. He was just a total dick. He's a dick to his real kids, too, because he had two real kids, and I was the kid that wasn't his, but he was like, that little motherfucker. So we'd go camping to San Felipe or Mexico all the time. He had family in Mexico. He was a big camper. He loved fishing. He had a boat. He had a boat. This motherfucker went out fishing for big ass fish. He was a crazy motherfucker. Didn't give a shit about me, but he was a crazy motherfucker and had his shit together. And he beat motherfuckers up and he beat my mom up and all that shit. But he knew how to have a good time. And he was a pothead. He smoked weed. He'd smoke weed right in front of me. He didn't give a fuck. And I hated that shit. That's why I grew up hating weed too, because he smoked weed. And we'd always listen to the Beatles, Supertramp on these long road trips to Mexico. It was always like 8 tracks of the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. He loved the Bee Gees too, but he loved ZZ fucking Top, The Doors, Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath. He was into rock, and I was into top. I would liked it, but reluctantly. I didn't really want to get too into it. You know, I liked it, but I wasn't really. It was a weird thing for me. I like Supertramp. I remember liking them as a kid. I'm like 6 years old.
The first album wasn't bad.
Goodbye, stranger. Yeah. It's been nice.
Yeah. I love that's a good. Shit. That had two or three good jams on it.
He's singing like fucking like Barry Gibb and shit.
Oh my God.
Like they let, you know what? If you have this magical tone, the people will let you get away. You know, they'll let you get away sounding like a little chipmunk as a guy. You know, they let the Bee Gees do it. They let Prince do it half the time. Like, you're such a bad motherfucker.
Neil Sedaka.
You know what I mean? They let motherfuckers do it every now and then. They let Supertramp do it. Yeah. Anyways, the dudes that sound like chicks with all the falsetto and all that shit. Sounds beautiful. Coldplay and all that shit. But anyways, so I remember 8 years old being at school, and there was going to be a Kiss movie on Channel 4. Kiss Meets the Phantom. I remember guys going, you're going to watch the, like 8 year old kids, you're going to play him in the fucking sand and shit. You're going to watch the Kiss movie? I'm like, fuck the Kiss movie. You know, I wanted to be cool. I'm like, because in 78, it wasn't cool to like Kiss. People were talking, like the kids were like talking shit on Kiss. I go, nah. I like the fucking Beatles and shit. You know what I mean? I was like claiming like my stepdad shit, but I wanted to hate it, but it was good music. But it was like a weird thing. So, that night, I was talking shit on Kiss at school, but that night, me and my brothers, 4 years older, we're just sitting there. We couldn't wait to watch this fucking Kiss movie everyone's talking about. Channel 4, 8 o'clock. That motherfucking movie just crushed my soul. Like, holy fuck. Kiss just became my life. It just, from that movie, I said, I don't give a fuck what these kids are saying. This is the greatest thing I've ever seen. It's like these comic book heroes. I mean, and then you hear Rock and Roll All Night. As an 8-year-old kid, that song fucking smashed me. I went like when the new PS3 came out and Cartman just grabbed his mom and said, we're going to the fucking store. And he's dragging his mom. That's how I dragged my aunt. We went to Jemco. We went to the fucking record store. I'm looking for Rock and Roll All Night. I'm 8 years old. And that was the thing. My aunts took me. They go, he wants this Rock and Roll. I was obsessed with Kiss. I dragged him to that goddamn store. We were Rock and Roll All Night, Rock and Roll All Night, Rock and Roll All Night. It was Kiss Alive 1. I didn't know what a live record was. Like live fucking record. My aunt didn't really know. She goes, I think this is a concert. I'm not sure. Because you turn the record over and it's a fucking arena where they show all the fans.
Yeah.
It's like a shot of them showing the fans. That's the back of the album.
That's Kiss Alive.
Kiss Alive, the first one. That's the one that blew them up.
Right, that's the one.
But that was 75. I was 78. They already had Kiss Alive too. By the time I got into them. I was like backtracking. They blew up and said, that's why they had the movie. Because they were just fucking, from Kiss Alive 1 is the one that made them retarded. They had three albums before that. They were kind of lukewarm. They weren't selling. Like, the record company was like, damn, I don't know. But the owner of the record company, was Casablanca, had faith in them. They were losing. They go, let's just put out a live record. Everyone loves us live. Because live, they were killing it. They were like fucking Cirque du Soleil back then, you know, with music. It was like they freaked people out. A lot of people were like, fuck you, that garbage circus shit. But a lot of people were like, fuck, listen to the songs. The songs are actually pretty good. Deuce and Strutter, those are some great fucking songs. And they had a crazy image. Most people didn't want to even listen to them because they're just like, these guys are like clowns. Look at them. But it was, to me, it was like, damn, they have great music and they have amazing image. They don't give a fuck. The shit they went through in the beginning, Kiss, when they slowly started putting on makeup, the early days, they just decide, people were booing, they were into the clubs and people were talking shit, they were playing in front of like two people, but they just fucking kept going at first it was just like leather, they were like the New York Dolls with a little bit more makeup. Definitely a lot more makeup. New York Dolls looking. And then they just started adding shit and they just became their own characters. Gene Simmons is like a big horror fan freak. Like, he's an encyclopedia with the horror movies and knows all the horror movies. He's like an expert. So that just became him. Paul, man, he became very effeminate. That is still a mystery. That is still a mystery. We don't know why he went that route. And then Ace decided to go. This is a band that fucking has, they're all characters. And they have makeup. And Ace was the total fucking cocaine. Space case. he was the one always high, so he became the spaceman. And he's trying to tell people he was into technology. He's trying to tell, they go, why are you the spaceman? They're interviewing him on fucking NBC because I'm into technology. Right? He became space. He's, that guy was crashing DeLoreans and making headlines and had coke all over his face in the ER and shit.
I had a mutual friend that said he had a glove box with a mirror on a slide, like the slide. Like you would pull the thing out. It's like he paid for somebody to go in there and put a mirror in there that slid under the thing so he could pop it out so he could snort coke.
That's awesome.
And here's the funny thing. Like Eddie and I were at Cobb's one time in San Francisco and we were working with Joe and Eddie told me a really interesting story. That's a one-man show. About, you know, when Kiss wasn't cool anymore.
Let me get to that. They became, remember the story though. I got to give the backstory. So I was so into them. I got the record, Kiss Alive. I put it on and then the record fades in with like audience. I'm like, what the fuck is that? I go, this is like a football game or something. I didn't know what it was. And then it was a concert, and then we got to Rock and Roll All Night, and I'm like, that's it. We went right to Rock and Roll. I'm like, that's it. I just went nuts. I became a Kiss freak.
I was eight.
I was behind on albums. They were already, I got into them when they exploded. I wasn't into the hardcore. I was too young. I was three. How could I be into their first album? So I had a backtrack, and I got $1 a week from my grandpa. Every Sunday, we went to church, and you had to go to church if you were going to go with us to the supermarket. Like, there was the big, it was the Walmart. Jemco was the Walmart of Orange County. We go to church, you have to go to church, and then we go to Jemco, and my grandfather would give me and my brother $1, and he had two kids that were me and my brother's age. We had two girls that we grew up to were like sisters. I grew up with sisters, but that were my aunts. My grandma and my mom were throwing kids out at the same time. So we would go to Sunday to church, every Sunday to church. You know, I wanted to get away from my goddamn dad. Sunday was away from my stepdad. I get to go with my grandparents to church. I hated church, but it was better than being with them. And then I knew I was going to get $1 at Jemco. So we'd go out, we'd all walk out, and it was like and then as soon as we get to the place where you can go to the fork in the road where you can go to the clothes department, the food, they went straight to the food. And while they went to the food, we went around to the rest of the store. I went to the record store, you know, the record part. My aunts went and looked for pants, and everyone does their own thing, but we have $1. I had to save $1 a week to get every record. It took forever to get those records. I was
behind. $7 then, right?
Yeah, $6.99, son.
$7.
It was hard for me to get these records, when I got
7 weeks.
And what I realized is I got into them when everyone was talking shit on them. At one point, they got so big. Kiss got so huge. They were massive. They became like MC Hammer.
Right.
They became Vanilla Ice. And MC Hammer was cool for a second. He was actually cool for a second. But then real quick, people turned on him. You know, they turn on you. If you're all like Image, they turned on Kiss. Kiss was making ice cream and pencils and shit. People were like, fuck you. Because that's when Ozzy came out. That was 78. Uh-huh. That's when, or not Ozzy. Yeah, Ozzy came out. Van Halen came out. Those were threats to me. Like Ozzy, I was like, shit. And I realized that I was into a band that went through a disco. They decided in 78 when they were losing their hardcore fans, they went to a more disco rock style.
Great song. I was made for loving you. I listened to that this morning too.
They went disco. And then they just died. They just kept dying from there. Kiss kept dying. They just fell apart.
Was that hard? Because did your friends like Kiss? Or were you the guy that liked Kiss so much?
Well, everybody,
you know what I mean? Like, how did that go down?
That's a good question. Now we're going to my friends growing up. Everybody, since we were all poor Mexicans, the one thing that differentiated our little Mexican neighborhood from everyone else's. I lived in Santa Ana, and Santa Ana is the East LA of Orange County. That's where they put all the Mexicans that work in El Toro and Lake Forest, all the people that cut grass. My grandfather was a landscaper. You know, he worked hard. They put them all in Santa Ana. That's where all the poor Mexicans. So, but our block was a bunch of Mexicans, different ages. Some, if you know, there was like the. I was, if I was 10, my brother was 14 and his brother, his friends were 15, 14. I had a couple friends that were 10. And then we had the 17-year-olds. And then we had the 25-year-olds all on the same block. And then we had the old fathers, you know what I mean? But we all had different age group growing up. And we all lived on the block. Sixth Street was the block. We all played football together. We all played basketball together. It was all of us. And I was part of the youngest generation initially. It was me and like three of us. So, and every dude had their band. Eric across the street, he was Rush and the Police. I own those motherfuckers. It was like whatever, whoever buys the album first, that's their band and you kind of like it, but my band's better. The records I buy are better. You know what I mean? Kiss was my band. And Honorio's band, he liked, he was Def Leppard. Matt was Journey and... what else? Everyone had their own band, and Kiss was my band. So when Kiss started dying, everyone started talking shit. Like when we'd be playing football or just hanging out, they go fucking. They would talk so much shit on me for liking Kiss, and like Matt liked Kiss too. He was a big Kiss fan, but he bailed. Matt bailed on Kiss. Too much pressure. I held on for a second. I held on longer than Matt, but I ended up buckling too. It was just too much pressure. Matt had to just claim Journey. Matt was just like Journey. He just claimed Journey. He goes, that's his shit.
That's, you know, awesome, what I mean? Joey.
He claimed Journey. And I, this is still before 10. We're still before 10. It's like 9 and 10. And I had to at one point pretend that I didn't like them.
Oh,
but
really?
I still did. I was a secret Kiss fan. Yeah. And then tell the story.
Now here's the other side of this. Here's the other side. So he's telling me this story how he would sneak the albums home. He would have to buy the album, sneak it home, and hide it under his bed because your brother was into somebody
oh,
else.
Oh, he was
also.
All Van Halen. My right. brother owned Van Halen.
Right.
He was so Van Halen.
He had dibs on Van Halen. So he had to, you know, play the albums and there's nobody home. And it's so weird because, you know, these are the things that make you as an adult that you hold on to. Until today, Eddie's a Kiss fan. And, like, it's weird. Because these guys don't think I like Kiss, so I don't talk about Kiss. My experience with Kiss is completely different. I grew up in a neighborhood where Kiss was hot. Now, before anybody had seen Kiss, my mother had this distant cousin, and their son, his name was Al Coelho, fucking crazy. And he dated this chick that was beautiful. And I was six, and they used to play boyfriend and girlfriend in front of me, and they were like 20. And one day, he went to get drugs, like weed, and he took me to see Kiss rehearse. I didn't know it was fucking Kiss.
That's insane.
I didn't know it was That's Kiss. Insane. He was going to meet his friend. Kiss wasn't big. Bro, I'm telling you, it was 71.
Yeah.
I was six
they were,
or
they
seven.
Were Wicked Lester, probably.
Right. So I was hard. You know, I didn't know who they were. I can't tell you I became a fan. I didn't know who the fuck they were. They just, years later, clicked on me. But then the neighborhood I moved to in Jersey was big. Black Led Zeppelin, Springsteen. We turned. We like Sabbath and all. We hated Deep Purple. We had this conversation.
Yeah,
I fucking
fuck
hate those motherfuckers.
I'm not into that.
So we were always Sabbath, the Stones, Led Zeppelin. But there was this kid down the corner who I was tight with, and he introduced me to the neighborhood, and he was a big Kiss guy. And he was a big Kiss Alive guy. And I still remember Beth, and then he got old enough and he got his own room. Felicia, and he made album covers. He took, how many albums did Kiss have in 78?
In 78, it was the four solo albums and double platinum.
Okay, so they
had like a greatest hits and four okay. solo albums.
So this kid, every time I go to his attic, we used to sneak Herb, you know, in the eighth grade, seventh mm-hmm. grade, we would sneak Herb and listen to Kiss. And Kiss wasn't really all that to me, but it was like that one that you said,
Strutter,
and the other one on Alive. Alive was my album.
Alive was a
that
good
was that's my album.
Album.
Alive was the
Alive,
one that it was
Alive
like.
Is a,
this is pretty fucking good.
There's
this
nothing,
is really good.
On Alive, there's nothing cheesy, or they ended up writing cheesy stuff later, but their first three albums were pretty good.
They're
like
they're solid.
It was darkness
solid. Pretty
them,
solid.
You know what I mean? It was there was some heaviness to them and some. Good shit. It's just they didn't sell that much. What sold was when they started getting cheesy, like Beth.
But Beth is a great
it's
fucking
a great
tune.
Song,
it's a great
but
tune.
Has nothing to do
it's
with,
a great tune.
It has nothing
I don't
to do with hard
shit.
Rock. You know what I mean?
I like that you have Beth's back
because it came out. Listen, anything that comes out in the seventh, eighth, or ninth grade that inspired your heart on, you will remember to the end of time.
Exactly.
And Beth was one of those songs you danced to. That was a slow song you had.
Oh, no.
She danced with me to Beth, bitch. What'd you get?
Yeah.
You didn't get titty or nothing. Why dance with her the best slow real tight? You know what I'm saying? Real tight. I can feel her pelvis real tight.
I'm sure
tight.
I got fingered during that song at some point in my life.
At some point.
I would buy an album, and this is what I did technically. I would buy an album and sneak into my backyard and put it behind my trash can and then come around, come inside, see if anybody was home. See, Junior, what's up? If no one's home, I go in the back and I grab it and I stick it and hide it under my bed. And this is what I would do too. And
let me ask you this though, real quick, Eddie. How did it feel to come out of the closet about your love for Kiss?
This is what happened. I wanted them to just fucking take off their goddamn makeup and play music. Because the music, I still liked the music.
Yeah.
They went through a lot of crazy shit.
So you were that guy. You wanted the makeup off.
I wanted the fucking makeup off so I don't have to hide no more. Just show them that you could do it. And like my friends would come over to my house and we'd be playing different records. I'd put on fucking Led Zeppelin. And I put on Led Zeppelin. I'm playing my stepdad's stereo. My stepdad's out of town and we have all the guys over. And he had the Fisher. Ooh, that stereo.
The
he had
Fisher, the good, yeah. With the 8-track cassette.
Yes.
And the turntable.
Yes. And the turntable.
And you could finance those back in the day.
And that was
for like $9
shit.
A week. I had one of those. That when you had a Fisher in the eighth grade, you were living large. Yeah. And because of the Fisher is why I do not like the cell phone with the camera and everything in it. That is why, because the Fisher would always tap out. Something would always go. But now you had to carry it around like fucking like crabs. You know, if the 8-track went, you still had to, you got stuck with the cassette and the fucking album.
Yeah, there was no cassette. It was just 8-track and turntable.
I had the one that had, dog, I went big time. I went big. I had the cassette with the fucking equalizer, with the button that you're pressing. You got higher music, so you get nice and fucking blasted. Because in those days, you could finance Fisher. No. Fisher had their own finance.
Well, that was my stepdad's, the Fisher.
Oh, right. If you were 14 and had a paper route, Fisher would finance you. For like $10 down. How fucking strong was that? That was the qualification. You have a paper out? Yes, I do. How long? 8 months. Fill this out. We'll have you pick a stereo. What can you do a week? You think I'm fucking joking?
No,
I'm not joking.
No,
this was back in the day when it was part of Christmas clubs. And we were talking about the Christmas clubs last week. And
in my room, like I had a little tiny record player and I had one speaker. I didn't know what stereo meant back then. Because, for those of you that don't know what stereo means now, it basically means there's two parts of the music, the left side and the right side, and they combine. There's some stuff that only plays on the left side, and there's some stuff that only plays on the right side, basically. There's two parts of music, the left and the right, and then you blend it in, right? I only had one fucking speaker, and I remember always listening to my Kiss records in my room on my record player. And then listening, it sounded so much different in on the Fisher. When my stepdad was around and I played, I'm like, I hear another guitar. It's like I heard like a brand new layer and shit. It was a trip because that's how rock players do it. Like if there's two guitar players, one dude is on the left speaker, one dude is on the right speaker. Separated. They rarely blend, especially metal bands.
It's amazing when you listen to old Led Zeppelin on those speakers. How you'll hear, if you have a whole lot of love and you have earphones on, and your one earphone goes, you're fucked a whole lot of love.
Yeah, exactly.
All you hear is cymbals. And
that's what I'm talking about.
It's like an evening in Peru. You know what I'm saying? You hear cymbals and bangs to the head and people yelling and shit. You don't.
That's really funny.
It's true.
Totally, you need to hear both together.
You need to be hearing both together. It's really weird how they taped in the
old
days.
Or in mono. If you only have one speaker, you put it in mono and it just mashes everything together. You know, and it sounds like shit. But we'd invite my friends over and we'd be playing, play Van Halen, play fucking Iron Maiden, like Iron Maiden was coming. And I would throw in a Kiss song. And then everyone would say, fuck, who's that? That sounds awesome. What is that? What is that? And I wouldn't say anything until they admitted they liked it. And I wouldn't say anything until I admitted they liked it. And then when they like it, I go, it's Kiss, dude. See, it's good, right?
It's good,
you liked it. You liked
it. No, but I knew, dog.
No, you liked it.
I knew the bass. I knew the bass, dog. I knew I was just
you
fucking
liked
with
it.
No, I was just fucking with you, dog. I didn't really like it. I just told you I like it. That's how the argument would start.
Yeah, exactly.
Because I'm from that old school also. I've told you a thousand times.
You sneak
times,
songs
dog.
On people.
When I was a kid, dog, it wasn't even the fucking, like, you could call me anything. I would. But I remember the heat that I went home was arguments over music. Like, I'd get home and, like, think about going back and stabbing you and then thinking, what is this all about? And then going, really, dog? Eddie Van Halen. We were getting into an argument about Van Halen and Clapton.
Yeah.
And who's fucking that? Fuck you, dog. You don't know what you talk. Fuck you. I got the album, bitch. My mother's not on welfare. You know, it would go into, it gets that deep. Like, it gets that deep, kids would know. If you had the album, see, if your mother wasn't a bartender, you know, and they would goof. Fuck you, my mother's a doctor. You know, it went, it escalated. Music is always, and that's why I don't involve myself. Like, when I hear bad music, I just keep my mouth shut. I won't even say nothing. Because I know how I get. I don't want to put up with it. I don't want to deal with it. Before I was 15, I bought everything. I bought everything. But after I was 15, I didn't have time for a bad fucking album. Like, I just didn't. And what I had to get was solid. And in those days, you couldn't duplicate. The only way you could duplicate is if you took an 8-track, the covers off the 8-track, the lids. You got to take 8-tracks, would have this little thing on it with,
That's right.
What the fuck you think you're dealing with, Joey Bananas? And you would have to take that tab off, put it in, connect it with wires, and have like a voodoo, like Red Band. In those days, Red Band was like a guy who put wires together and who broke into houses. Like, dog, I need to tape Led Zeppelin onto another 8-track. Oh, my brother can do it for you. He'll be over later. You got to give him like a 6-pack of beer. And he come over with cigarettes. And you had to put two machines together and then take, you know, take like an arm, like steal an 8-track from your mom, like that she didn't like or she wasn't, you know what I'm saying? Because you needed that motherfucker. You got to take like the Gone with the Wind or something on 8-track when she wasn't looking.
You tape over that. I did the same thing.
Oh, we all did.
I would tape over all that.
You took the tabs off like a motherfucker. You put that fucking thing in, you taped it, and then you had to take it off, rip the label off, which 8-track labels were fucking
hard, dude.
Houdini! You had to get like the razor blade all night and scrape it off and then paint it over with something because moms could tell. What is that? That's my 8-track. No, it ain't. Where'd you get it from? I found it. No, it's not. It's my Gone with the Wind. Fuck you.
Dude, everybody knew bro, that, dude.
To think that's what's great about technology now, that in the old days, you know, now you just press a button, right? Record or
dude,
enter.
I thought 8-tracks were space age. I'm like, holy
shit. Oh, my
shit.
God, yeah.
There was like four different tracks that
four
clicks
on.
Four
tracks and shit. 8-tracks would cut into a song, though. That's something that cut right into a song. You know what I'm saying? I need it. Wow. I want. What the fuck is that? Wow.
Click.
And then we go click. I need it. Wow. And then we come back at you.
And this is the weird thing about Kiss. And again, no band has ever done what they've done. They came back into the reunion and it was a smash hit. People loved the makeup. They dropped the makeup because it was a joke. The makeup was making them like Vanilla Ice. They had to. But now they bring it back in 95 and everybody wants to see it. Everyone's all nostalgic and, oh my God, it's back. And the original members with makeup.
Did you
holy
go?
Fuck yeah. Fuck yeah, man. I went there and they kept doing it. They kept coming back. They kept with another tour and then another tour. I was getting third row, second row. I was spending all the cash I had just to be right there in the front. And this is the crazy thing is, in the original Kiss, when all first four members were around, they actually lost the drummer because that's the guy that wrote Beth and he wanted to do his own shit anyways, and he was a drunk. They cut him out and brought in a new guy who became a fox. They needed a new character, and he became, he was the fox, Eric Carr.
Yeah.
And then they got rid of Ace Frehley, the space guy, because he was just wrecking DeLoreans and all fucking coke, and he was out of control. And they brought in a new guy named Vinnie Vincent. He was an Egyptian. So for like a year or two, a couple years, there was no more Ace. There was no more Ace, Space Ace. There was no Peter Criss the Cat. For like a couple years, there was Eric Carr, the fox, with Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley, still the same. And then this Egyptian guy, he had an onk on his face. His name's Vinnie Vincent. He was the new guy. So when they actually let the makeup go, it was Vinnie Vincent and Eric Carr, the fox guy, that came out unmasked with Gene and Paul. We still hadn't seen Peter and Ace back in the day, right? They changed characters. So now, fast forward to the reunion, for the same reasons, after like the third reunion, they got rid of Peter and they got rid of Ace the same way the first time. But they kept, Paul and Gene kept going. They got replacements, but this time they got replacements, not as new characters, but they got guys to play the space guy and a guy to play the cat, the original guys, instead of switching it. So that was like an imposter Ace playing on stage. They didn't hide it. They admitted it. You could read about it. But they knew that most people wouldn't read. They knew that most people that went to the show were like, oh, shit. They knew they were fooling like 50% of the audience. They never hit it. They said Tommy Thayer as Ace Frehley. Eric Singer as the cat guy, Peter Criss. It was insane. So now you're seeing Kiss, but there's two dudes. Isn't that weird? They decided to go a different route this time. Fuck that. We're going to keep the characters and just get new dudes. And they did
really,
it.
You really, really, really are a Kiss fan. I love that about you.
But this is what happened.
Well, you know what?
We got to take a breather here. Yeah. If not, Jesus Christ, for fucking Christ. This is what happened.
I'd have to keep
that's the last time I'll
podcast.
Give you a bong hit before a fucking podcast, cocksucker.
Anyway. Bottom line, I want to end with Gene Simmons is a bad motherfucker. And he has a reality show like Ozzy. That's the end. I'm going to end with that. Is Gene Simmons can be arrogant. He can be pompous. I give him permission.
I love him. I love him too. So we'll be back, bitches. So anyway, you were saying, you dirty bitch.
Oh, you know what's funny is after the interview with Eddie Bravo yesterday, we were outside and smoking a cigarette and you guys were telling me this funny story about how you and him drive Joe Rogan crazy with the music stuff. It made me laugh so hard. Tell the story about when you guys were on the trip.
We were on an Austin trip one time. And you know, when we're in the car, sometimes we get lost in these conversations about life and whatnot. And we stopped at like a record store, you know, and you buy shit that's obscure. You know, you don't want to buy the obvious and stuff. I think somebody bought like Leonard Skinner, you know, whatever. And Eddie Bravo buys the best of Rhett, you know, which is like, are you fucking crazy? You know, but Rhett had two good albums, you know, uh-huh. The EP they put out, the one album, and then the second one, Lay It Down in 85. And after that, it was just a fucking nightmare. They were horrible live, but those couple of songs were cool. And I liked them. What happened was they stayed at the Sheraton Center in New York City. I was bartending there, so I started talking to them. And the one guy was cool, so I listened to the album. And I'm like, these guys, they weren't bad. The guitar player was bad to the bone. So me and Eddie start talking about the guitar player, and Eddie's looking at me like, how the fuck do you know about this obscure shit? And we keep going for an hour, and now we got the whole fucking truck talking about Rat, and the uncle was Milton Berle. That's why Milton Berle did the albums. He was the drummer's uncle or the cousin or something. Milton Berle brought those videos to life. He did the first two videos. Round and round, what comes around. So we're all throwing tidbits out about Rat. And Joe Rogan's like, what the fuck are you guys talking about? You know, it was like, because it was overwhelming.
Yeah.
Sometimes
no,
when you
I
bring music up,
now.
And when you bring up people with music, sometimes, like I said it before, dog, you can call me fat fuck, spick, you're no good, whatever. But when it comes to music, I get fucking offended. Like this morning, I'm throwing heat on Facebook and somebody throws Bob Dylan at me. Listen, there's a time and a fucking place for Bob Dylan, and it ain't at 6 in the morning, stupid. It ain't at 6 in the fucking morning. So you can never be a good DJ because you're bringing me down with that fucking Nasonex. You know what I'm saying? In the mornings, you got to be alert. You're going to fucking send me Bob Dylan with that fucking nutcase.
The
at
Nasonex.
6 in the, yeah, I don't need that shit at 6 in the fucking morning. That's horrible. Bob Dylan's a great American songwriter, but he's in the afternoon when you got 19 joints in you, when you're counting your 20s in your pocket. That's when Bob Dylan's all right. But to get me motivated, I can't get motivated to fucking Bob Dylan. So you failed as a fucking DJ, cocksucker. You know what I'm saying? But back to the Joe Rogan thing. I remember him calling me later on. He's like, dog, you got to lighten up with the music shit. You kill, you know? And even till this day, Joe and me always, we like music.
Uh-huh.
You know, comedians love music. Comedians are crazy about music. In a way, we're aspiring musicians that don't have the fucking balls. At least I am. So there's not like me and Jerry LaRocca. Our conversation is based around music.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's it. As nerdy
as... What's his
band?
What's his number one?
Pink Floyd.
Oh, yeah.
Me and him are Pink Floyd freaks to the end, and he knows. And he likes music. He likes classic, the Stone. Like, he called me the other day. I'm like, what's up? You know, like in the middle of your day when people call you, I'm like, what's up? And he's like, dog, I don't know if you know this, they're re-releasing Some Girls on the 20th of November. Some Girls, for people who don't know it, is a fucking masterpiece. And they're redoing it, you know? It's I have friends that, you know, like somebody said to me once, you have friends that don't get high. Jerry knows everything about music but refuses to get high. Even with his vertebrae problem now, you know he's having a hard time getting on stage.
Really?
He could just do like one set a night, then he has to go home and stretch. I told him the other day, I go, Jerry, I think it's time for you to eat some banana bread. You know, he's a nerdy guy. He's like, yeah, yeah, yeah. I go, I'm fucking serious. He goes, Joey, I can never do that.
Yeah.
That's how straight he is. But don't sit with him and argue about music, because he'll fucking shred you. Yeah, he'll just shred you.
You can see Jerry Rocha on one of our videos that we did at Sal's.
10-10-10. Yeah, the video 10-10-10. So yeah, Felicia.
But anyway, it was really funny yesterday the way you were doing Joe Rogan, getting all pissed off at you guys playing music. I really enjoyed Eddie Bravo. I really enjoyed that conversation when he started talking about buying the Kiss album and Secret and hiding in behind the dumpster. And it was really
when he
really
first
nice.
Told me the story of Cobbs, Felicia, I felt his pain, because it was a pain a little boy has about something. There's always something that you like that somebody else don't like, that you got to keep like a secret. There's always something, you know, when there's some boys that like Donny Osmond. You know, when girls sat around and said, that sucked. There's got to be, you know, you ever watch Rockstar? The movie Rockstar with Marky Wahlberg.
Yeah, yeah,
it's a great movie. And there's one part where the manager says to him, dog, it's not girls that like the rock musician. It's guys, because they want to be like you. So when my wife comes home and says, I like Marky Wahlberg, my first thing as a man, I'm jealous.
Yeah.
Fuck Marky Wahlberg. Oh, he took it in the ass in 84. You know those guys will find an excuse. He made out on a movie set when he was 81, you know. What the fuck? You know what I'm saying? Because we're insecure. But we like Marky Wahlberg. We like that rap or something. There's always, bro, somebody buys Britney Spears albums.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Some guy?
No, somebody buys Britney Spears albums. I don't, you don't.
Right.
Your kids don't. Somebody's buying them. She's a millionaire multi because somebody buys her fucking music. And it can't all be little girls. It's got to be people that listen to it and, like, don't tell other people that they listen to it.
When I was,
this was his pain. His pain was Kiss. His pain. When he told me he used to have to sneak the album, like he said yesterday, and behind the garbage can and yell for his brother and go outside and sneak it in. I did the same thing, but I did it for wrong reasons. Because my mom would say, where'd you get the money to buy the album? Do you know what I'm saying?
I always had
to sneak shit outside and leave it.
Really?
Yeah, because I always had this extra dough. And my mom would say, where'd you get that money? Like, people come to, like, my mother made a rule one time. When you come to the bar, you're not allowed to give Coco money. But there were still people that would get fucked up, and they would meet me by the pool table and slip me, like, a 50. So I would go out the next day and buy a knife, a bike, you know, whatever. And then I'd come home, and she'd go, where'd you get
the knife? Exactly why she didn't want you to have
a slingshot. Something, you know, something I wasn't supposed to fuck. No. Something that you go to your mother for and say, Ma, I want a slingshot. No, you can't have it. And a week later, I got it.
Yeah.
You know, she would say, where the fuck did you get the money? So I understand the hiding thing. Music is a motherfucker.
Yeah.
People, when you're a little kid, it's a like, I remember I wanted to play one time. I wanted my G.I. Joe to have the Barbie dollhouse. I went to this girl's house and we were playing. I'm like, wow, Barbie's got a house with a top floor and a pole.
I had one of those.
Yeah. You know the one that you open up and it goes sideways?
Yeah. I had the airplane.
Yeah.
Camper.
And
yeah,
I remember going, oh my God, what if I get the Barbie house, bring it home, and I play G.I. Joe's with it? My fucking mother found it. Do you understand me? And they sat me down and they sat me down and that. It's really interesting. I'm writing this book, I was telling you. And it was
really,
because there was a certain age that my mom was raising me alone. It was just me and my mom. And somebody came to my mom and goes, can you talk to me for a second? This kid's getting a little spoiled. This kid, he could go either way. You don't have a man in his life. So my mom freaked out. So she started throwing me around the toughest, craziest motherfucker she could find to make sure.
Yeah.
Like people that had grown up with my dad that knew us from Cuba, she would go, take him for a ride and explain the situation to him.
Right.
So, yeah, it was really weird. So when they caught the Barbie doll, they were like, Joey, are you going to...
How old were you?
I was about 8 or 7 or 8 or 9. They were like, are you fucking serious?
It just cracks me up that Joey Diaz brought home a
Barbie doll. I remember coming home and my mom was sitting there with two guys with guns on the table and they're like, let's go for a ride. You know what I'm saying?
Hand over the townhouse.
And they're like, what the fuck is going on with you, dog? You bought a pink house?
You didn't try to paint it or glue
no,
sand
I
on
wanted
it.
To, and I even bought a Barbie so the G.I. Joe could fuck her. Like, I had the whole scenario. So they were like, are you fucking serious?
Oh, my God. Like, that's such a psychological experiment right there.
I get home and there's like guns on the table and they're like, you know, Tati wants to take you for a ride. And you get me in the car and they're like, do you like broads? You know, what's going on with you? You know, do you want to go see a tit? Do you want to see a pussy? And I'm like, you know, and that's the,
right. Right.
It's so weird that when I got in trouble, I thought about all those times when I was a kid. And while I was, while they were giving me manhood talks, they were also conducting their business.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So come on, let's go over to my girlfriend's house. And I go over there and they'd be cooking. I go, I thought that Maria was your wife. Shh, is my girlfriend. So I was like, they introduced me to their own personal thing to show me their manhood.
Right.
And I would come home like, Ma, they, shh, don't say a word. I don't want to know about it. But, you know, and then they would look, my mom would look at the guy and go, did you talk to him? Yeah, we talked. Everything's
so
gonna be
when
all
you got home, was the townhouse there?
No, they lit that thing on fire. They set that shit packing. Like, it was fucking embarrassing, you know? Yeah. But
what
are you going to do?
That's crazy.
And my mom even used to say, if this happens again, you know they're going to take you shark hunting.
Yeah.
And I would go, what's shark hunting? That's an old thing they do in Cuba when they think you're going to be a little wackadoolious. They just take you shark hunting and throw you off the fucking boat, and that's the end of that fucking tour.
Well, that story's not as amazing.
That's cold fucking blooded, Felicia. That's cold blooded.
That's crazy. That's crazy. Anyway, but I did enjoy. I'm changing the subject.
Felicia, you didn't see this.
No, I don't want to see. I've seen the
picture. No, but you didn't see the nutsack. It's coming out. Like, just the nutsack.
That looks like fucking the biggest venereal wart on the planet, Joey. That's really, and it shrinks back in. And you know what? I'm staring at it as he does it.
This is my ball sack. Look how nice it is. No hair.
All right,
nice
all
and
right.
clean.
All right.
You want to sniff it?
No, okay,
come on,
okay.
Just give
so
a little
no
sniff.
One's going to take you out shark hunting. Okay. But anyway, it was a really fun interview with Eddie, and it was really cool to see you guys talk about music, and I'm so glad. And the whole thing is, I was like, wanted to ask him. I was so like, wanted to ask him this. You know, Eddie, the Beauty and the Beast podcast is all about second chances. Can you share with us when you had a second chance? I was actually going to ask him that because we're trying to be more slick and professional, right? And then he started that story about Kiss, and it turned out to be one of the most wonderful memories I have so far on Beauty and the Beast.
Let's get the fuck out of here. People, go to iTunes and leave a comment because it'll make our ratings go higher. And then in turn, we get more sponsors and we can work better things out for you.
We landed in the What's Hot list up like one time. We landed somewhere on number 18. So we definitely would appreciate it.
We need you people more than ever. Number two, we're available for comedy dates. If you have a corporate event or something you want to hire us, get to us on the webpage. Either Felicia or myself or both of us will come and rock your fucking world. And beside that, you know what? We love you. We want to thank you for all the great numbers and for spreading the word and for watching us grow.
And if you have any thoughts that you would like to share with us, please email us at beautyandthebeastpodcast@gmail.com. Joey loves to answer them.
That's right, bitches. Have a great week. We love you and stay black. Oh, any dates, Felicia?
I'm going to be at Sardo's November 30th.
Okay. I will be at the new Madhouse Comedy Club. November 25th and 26th in San Diego. Get your tickets now, bitches.
Wow, I might have to come down and see that.
No, stay home and mind your fucking business. Have a great weekend. Stay black. I love you.
Damn it. Mwah. Mwah.